Good evening. Thank you. Good evening. Can you all hear me? Okay, awesome. So I am Dr. Sarah Chavez. I teach for the School of Interdisciplinary Arts and Sciences, and I'm also one of this year's co-coordinators for the Latino Studies minor. I feel very privileged to have been asked to MC this very cool event with our guests. I do have a little bit of a spiel, but I'm super excited to sort of get going. And I was asked to let you all know that this is being recorded, but not you all. It's just like the front of the room. But so if you want your voice in perpetuity to like say something wacky in the middle of an event, now is your time. Okay. So thank you, everyone, for joining this Disability Awareness and Hispanic or Latinx, as some of us say, Heritage Month event, a talk and Q&A with Chicano artist Jake Prendes. This event is representative of the exciting interdisciplinary programming offered at UW-Tacoma, including the strong commitment that staff, faculty, and administration in the School for Interdisciplinary Arts and Sciences, as well as staff, administration, and student advocates in the Office of Disability Resources for Students, have to foster visible representation and inclusivity. This event is particularly significant in this time of year, as October intersects with two national celebrations, Latinx Heritage Month, those last 15 days in September, and the first 15 days in October, where institutions are encouraged to recognize the contributions and influence of Latinx Hispanic Americans to the history, culture, politics, and art achievements in the United States, which are, in my opinion, and statistically, undertaught and underrepresented at every other time of the year. We can fix that, though. And Disability Awareness Month, celebrated annually in October to raise awareness about the support and rights of people with disabilities. To bring together the two celebrations is to reflect the intersectionality of identity and culture that is the reality of lived experience. This year, technically on September 26th, marks the 50th anniversary of Section 504 of the Rehabilitation Act of 1973. Section 504 of the Rehabilitation Act is the foundational civil rights law that established protection from discrimination for individuals with disabilities in the United States and requires the University of Washington to provide equal access to programs, services, and activities. To learn more about this landmark in civil rights, please visit the UW Office of Americans with Disabilities Act Coordinator's website for more information on other events and programs. As students in my Chicanx literature class just about like 2.5 hours ago know, while we may celebrate specific aspects of our identities, such as race, ethnicity, gender, sexuality, familial roles, education, etc., humans' true nature is built through the entanglement of those identities, which at times can feel contradictory or in conflict. Certainly, they affect how we move through the world, including in education and the arts. Recognition of this intersectionality of culture and identity is why we are so thrilled to introduce Jake and Judy to speak of his journey, specifically Jake as a person whose multiple identities have at times been hard to navigate, especially in regard to disabilities and ethnic communities. So I'm gonna read both of their bios and then pass the mic over. So we have Jake Prendes, a renowned Chicano artist and scholar who is owner and co-owner of the Napantla Art Gallery on the border of West Seattle and White Center. His oil paintings and digital artwork represent an amalgamation of his life experiences, including living back and forth from Los Angeles and Seattle, including a specific focus on themes relating to Chicanx and indigenous culture, social justice, pop culture, and satire. He exhibits his art and lectures across the country. Jake is also a strong advocate for youth empowerment and the power of positive reinforcement. Judy Avitia Gonzalez was born in the Boyle Heights neighborhood of East Los Angeles to Mexican immigrant parents. Her family moved to Seattle in the early 90s and settled in the White Center neighborhood. She's become a strong and trusted community organizer, which over the years has led to many close partnerships with community groups and cultural arts organizations. Judy as the other co-director of the Napantla Cultural Arts Gallery, hopes the gallery will create a welcoming space for community, especially for youth, something she did not feel she had growing up. So please join me in a warm welcome for Jake and Judy.
Hello, all right, it works. Let's see if this works. It does, okay, cool. Isn't that a cute kid? So my name is Jake Prendez, and I'm actually gonna be doing something a little different. My presentation usually is called The Art of Rebellion, Social Justice and Chicano Visual Arts, and I'm looking at how art has, through time, we use protest art to mobilize communities, to get our messages out of social justice, how those movements influence the next generation of artists, and so on and so forth, and I deconstruct my art. Today, I'm actually gonna be doing a little bit more about myself and hopefully a motivational talk of kind of how I got here and the Napantla Cultural Arts Gallery. So I'll be completely honest with you all. I hated school. It's funny to say that at university, but from my first day of kindergarten to my last day of high school, I was not a fan. I kind of had two strikes against me. One, I come from a low-income family, so kind of I didn't really think I was ever going to go to college, just monetarily, like we can't afford. And number two, I'm dyslexic. And it was undiagnosed dyslexia until I was, done with my coursework for my master's degree, right? So I was like, wow, that would have been great information to have while I was in school. So my parents wanted me tested for dyslexia in like first grade. I was showing a lot of signs, right off the bat, as soon as we started like learning to read, things like that. And the school refused. They were like, oh no, he's not dyslexic. We don't need to test him. It's an expensive test. And they just didn't want to spend the money. So instead what they did is they stuck me in these special help classes kind of all through elementary. So I grew up with this very low self-esteem. Like I'm stupid, I'm dumb, I hate myself. And by the time I got to middle school, that anger, that frustration manifested in unprogressive means, right? And so I kind of went from that really good kid in elementary school, the teacher's trying to talk to us, we gotta be quiet, to the angry teenager by the time I got to middle school. And I know you can't tell it now because I'm so clean cut and dapper, but I was a cholo in high school. Judy still doesn't believe it, but I got pictures to prove it. Look at that. Vatos locos forever. So I kind of, I grew up, I was born in Southern California out by Riverside, a little town called Hemet. But I moved to Bothell like when I was like five, right? And when we moved up, I think we were the only Mexican family in town. My grandparents used to send us boxes of pan dulce like every month. So that was like a cherished package, right? And by the time, think about it, you're getting shipped a box of pan dulce, and it's like, it ain't the freshest when it gets to us, So we would have to put a little butter on the top of the conchas and microwave for a few seconds just to kind of soften it up a little. Now there's a really bomb panaderia right down the street from me, and I'm just I feel God, the sacrifices my family used to make, and now it's so accessible. So again, by middle school, I met some homies and made some friends, and we were kind of the brown kids. We were the kids that were kind of the town didn't approve of, or and there was kind of this influx in Bothell, kind of early 90s, right? And so a lot of my friends were, like, they started getting involved in gangs and things like that, and their families kind of moved them out of these different areas, like Pacoima, California, Tacoma, different neighborhoods, to kind of, let's get them in the suburbs and maybe they'll save them. So we didn't have enough, like, Mexican kids to, like, have a Mexican gang. We didn't have enough, like, Black kids have a Black gang. So we started a crew called Different Shades of Brown. And it was Mexicans, it was Cambodian Blacks, it was Korean, Filipino. And we hung out, like, we were, like a crew, right? We just hung out with each other, like, that protection, right? And so a lot of it was this, like, frustration that I kind of grew up with, this, like, hatred of myself. And it manifested, it's like, I was teased, I was humiliated. Like, I had mean teachers, too. Like, I had a teacher that, like, one time I was like, Jake is so messy, class. I need someone to take him in the back room and show him how to make his notebook neat. You know, like, just, like, shut up. Like, jerk. And so you just kind of, if I wasn't going to get respect, I was going to get it through intimidation, I guess, or, you know, like, if you're not just going to respect me as a human being, it's through fear that you're going to respect us, you know, and I think that was kind of our mindset, and it's like, but it's also this weird, like, I'm actually really a nice guy, I'm funny, but, you know, y'all treat me like this, so this is what you get. So I always kind of say the community kind of created us, and by the time I got to high school, like, I loved art, I'm here because of art, basically. So I always was drawing. I loved to draw, and I was, and it was like kind of that one thing I was good at. When we get to math and all those things that I suck at, spelling, they would just put me in a coat room with, like, kind of the other kids that needed special help, and I get my lesson in there. And it was really humiliating because you had to leave your whole classroom, like, all your homies and friends, and be like, okay, guys, I'm not smart enough to hang out with you right now, so I'm just going to go in this coat room now. See you at recess, right? So doing that on a daily basis, it just took a toll on my ego. But by high school, you know, I was kind of this full-fledged cholo aesthetic. Granted, this is when Blood and Blood Out and American Me came out, so heavily influenced. But I was always drawing, like, lowriders and cholos and cholas and zoot suiters and things like that. And I thought, like, okay, art is the one thing I get positive reactions for, is the art I'm creating, especially, like, you know, elementary and stuff like that, and in middle school. And, like, back in the day, we used to have, like, folders, you know, or notebooks, and they had, like, that plastic clear front, and you'd put your pictures and things like that. And so I would, like, every week, and I'd work on a new, like, drawing, and I'd put it in the front, and I'd get on the bus, and I'd be like, and I, like, and the kids be like, yeah, you know, like, people, like, literally would, like, wait to see, like, my new drawing for the week, and that's what I loved, and it's what I, you know, like, the one thing I got actual positive reaction for. But by the time I started taking art classes in high school, again, I had just jerk racist teachers that, you know, told me literally my art was too ethnic, too gangster, you can't do that. And I ended up going to a community college only because my best friend's older sister had gone to a community college. His parents were making him go, and he didn't want to go alone. Does that make sense? So he's like, come on, dog, let's go check out this community college in fall. And I was like, man, fool, like, I'm done with school. Like, I ain't going to go do more of this. He said, man, there are going to be hot girls there. I was like, that's something to think about. So I ended up going to community college, and I thought I was going to do art. And I heard that same feedback from the art teachers there. And so I just gave up art at that point and stopped creating art from the time I was 19 till I was 30, right? So this whole time, I got into community college. I worked my butt off, and, like, I hate math to this day still. I think there's a math mafia out there. They're going to take all this math. But I would go to the math lab every day after class, and I would do my homework in the math lab. That way, if I didn't understand something, they could explain it to me. And better yet, they checked my homework. So I was able to pass all my math classes and finally got through college level math. And I'm not joking, I threw a last math class party when I passed college level math. I was like, I'm having a pachanga, man. No more math. So by this time I had a son. I was 19, and he kind of straightened me out. I was like, okay, now there's someone that this little baby like depends on me for life. Like, I can't be a knucklehead anymore, man. I gotta do something with my life. And so worked really hard. My first quarter at Bellevue Community College, I got a 0.8 GPA. I got a C, a D, and an F. By the time I was ready to transfer, I got it up to about a 2.75, I think, which it's aight. It's not a stellar GPA by any means, but it's not bad. It's aight. But the work that it took to get there, right? And I applied to University of Washington, and I got denied. And I was crushed. And I was like, man. And I wasn't going to give up. And I met this woman. She was a counselor. Her name was Ana Luera. Do you remember Ana at all? She worked at Minority Affairs. So she helped me write letters of appeals. And through appeals, I got into UW. And I remember my first day at UW, and I feeling pretty cocky, like, I'm at UW now, what's up? And Ana introduced me to this guy who worked in Office of Minority Affairs. I'm not going to say his name, but she's like, oh, this is Jake. We got him into, you know, the UW, and Jake, this is so-and-so. And I remember he told me, we got you in, don't F it up for us. I'm like, for real, fool? Like, you ain't gonna say something positive or affirming, like, go get him, Tiger, you can do it. You know, like, you're gonna say something stupid. I was like, all right, you just made my shit list, homie. Like, I ain't gonna forget you. Well, my first semester, I did American Ethnic Studies, because I dropped the art, right? So I did American Ethnic Studies, Concentration Chicano Studies. I was taking classes I loved. My first quarter at University of Washington, I got a 3.8 GPA. I ain't never had A's in my life. And now I was on the dean's list, you know, and I was, next time I saw a homeboy, I was like, yeah, you didn't think I could do this, right? Wu-Tang in your face, right? He's apologized to me since, and he's a fan of my art. But anyways, so going back, like, one thing I want to say, so I'm at this point, I'm in college, I'm doing good, but it's, you know, I'm taking an ethnic study class, things I love and I'm very passionate about, right? I got through the general ed barely. So I have major imposter syndrome that whole time. I feel like, so the dyslexia is still completely undiagnosed. I just feel like I'm stupid, and at some point, they're going to find out I've been faking it this whole time, and they'll be like, ah, your test came back, and we can tell you're dumb. We're going to have to kick you out of UW, right? Like, so I'm like just nervous, like, man, they're going to find out, like, So I graduate from University of Washington. Even though I have imposter syndrome, I also, I'm very cocky. I have confidence, though. And I didn't want to stop, and I wanted to go on and get my master's degree. So I moved back to LA. I went and I did my master's in Chicano Studies at Cal State Northridge, right? Large Chicano Studies program in the nation. And I actually got recruited by Rudy Acuña, so he's like the godfather of Chicano studies, like, so, and so that was like a big honor, like, oh my God, Rudy Acuña wants me to come here and all this stuff. So I ended up going, loved it, fell in love with Cali again. I was like, yeah, this is where I belong, kind of thing. And still, I feel like a complete imposter, like I don't, like, I'm in class with like some brilliant students, and I can hear them talk, and they're using those $5 words all the time. And I'm just like, dang, like, I need to learn some of these words. And like I remember to say that, oh, the paradigm is shifting. And I'm like, I don't even remember any of those words. Can't even make a joke about it. But I had gotten through my coursework for my master's degree. So I was done with the coursework. I was ABD, all but dissertation, right? And I was working at Cal State Northridge. I was a college recruiter. And I was lucky enough, like, we were doing like a college fair. And we had to shuttle a bunch of like people from different departments, like from the business department, from humanities, from disability services, from, you know, different things. And they were each going to have like kind of a table, and all these families come and they get and talk to the different departments and people about the school and different programs. It's a really cool way to do it. And so I got to take a bunch of those folks and shuttle them over there. So I'm driving, and Sydney Shotgun is one of the, I think she might have been the director of Disabled Student Services, Dr. Z. And I'm talking, and we're chatting, I'm telling her how, like, man, I think I'm dyslexic. Like, I've always thought I was dyslexic. And, like, I even, like, looked up signs of dyslexia. And, like, some of these are crazy. And I, like, man, that's me, you know? Like, people think, like, dyslexia, like, oh, you read backwards? No, I don't read backwards. Like, my brain just processes information differently, right? But there's weird things, like, on this list of signs of dyslexia that, like, I would have never thought had anything to do with dyslexia. Like, for example, they say you're an early walker, but you have trouble jumping as a toddler. I was an early walker, and my family made fun of me because I couldn't jump as a toddler. I was like, dang, that's crazy. One of them is you write one-handed, right? But you play sports the other hand. I'm lefty. I write left-handed, but I played baseball right-handed. I'm like, dang, that's crazy. So I was telling her this. She's like, hey, I'm the one who does the testing for the campus. Make an appointment with me. Let's get you tested. I take the test. So first day, taking this test, and I'm bombing it. I'm like, dang, at least I'm proving I'm dyslexic. And at the end, she comes and grabs the test. She's like, all right, that completes our IQ portion of the test. I'm like, oh, okay, I'm just dumb. Oh, you know? And so I come in for the second day of testing, and she's like, hey, when you're done with today's test, come see me. I want to talk to you. I was like, okay, hope I'm not in trouble. And so I take the second round, come talk to her, and she has these two graphs. And she's like, the first one, and I forget the names of these two, but there's these two graphs, and she's like, this first one's kind of your the math science stuff, right? And she's like, you're on the cusp of below average. But this other graph, this is that kind of creative side, right? You're in the brilliant range. It's like, when I see two numbers that far apart, I know something is happening in your head. I can't tell you it's dyslexia yet because we got more tests, but I can tell you that's a sign. Well, guess what? I passed the test. I'm dyslexic, right? And so it was very emotional for me because it was that, like, I told y'all, like, I'm not dumb. Like, there was something going on and no one believed me, you know? And, like, that feeling of I always thought I was gonna get, like, found out that I was not, that I didn't belong, that I was really stupid this whole time, and I didn't belong here, like, and I wasn't, you know, so there was, I was, like, on the verge of crying, and I told her, I was like, I always thought I was cheating, like the way I was doing my homework, is I always thought, like, I was cheating. She's like, no, that's very common. What you had to do was double what everyone else was doing. You had to take that information, reprocess it in your brain so that it made sense to you, and then you did the homework. I was like, yeah, that's what I was doing. So it was one of those aha moments for me that changed my life, because it made me think, there's things I suck at. I'm on the cusp of a low average on something, right? There's things that I'm just not going to be great at. Why am I going to kill myself trying to do that stuff? When there's something I'm brilliant at, something I'm good at, why not focus on that? And that is the point in my life where I focused on art, where I refound art. So I hadn't done art, you know, there's this 10-year gap. I was fortunate, in my grad program, I took this art painting class. And it was a Chicano studies class taught by Irene Cervantes, famous Chicana artist. But it was like a painting class. So I took this class, and like the first project is like self-portrait. And I need to add that to my slide, note to self. But I had to do a self-portrait. You know, you have a mirror, and you just kind of paint yourself. And so I thought it was amazing. Like, I was like, man, y'all rest of y'all in this class, y'all suck compared to, like, you see mine? And thank God I liked it at the time because I just kept at it. I kept painting after the class. And, I mean, I look at that painting now, I'm like, wow, that's crap. But thank God I liked it at the time. But, like, art, it's like a musician, right? Dizzy Gillespie wasn't Dizzy Gillespie the first time he picked up a trumpet, right? It's through practice and practice and practice that he honed his skill. And that's the same thing with painting, right? Every painting, every drawing you do is going to be a little bit better than the last one. But you keep at it, and you keep at it. And eventually, 15 years later, you're doing this, right? That's in a nutshell kind of my story and my journey. So what I want to do now is I want to actually just deconstruct some of my artwork and show you what I'm creating. And then I want to, got a special treat today. This amazingly beautiful and talented woman here, my fiance, Judy Avitia Gonzalez, she's going to talk about what we're doing at the Napantla Cultural Arts Gallery and our mission and all this amazing stuff. And this is actually on top. I mean, she's an amazing talker now. If you've seen us on the news and stuff, like, she's really good. But this is really her first lecture, combined lecture together, and I'm really excited. So we're going to talk about that as well. Does that sound good to everyone? Cool. Oh, I forgot I have this. Okay. Before I do that, I want to show you this video. So I was fortunate about 10 years ago now, 10 LA artists had the opportunity to go paint a mural in Guanajuato, Mexico. It was getting tagged up really bad on the back of like an interno, like kind of a convent. They housed like abused women and children, and the nuns wanted a mural to be painted on the back because to kind of detour the tagging. And so we were contacted like, hey, would y'all be interested? Here's the kicker, it's for nuns, they don't have money. You'd have to pay for everything yourself. So we fundraised for a year and through all these parties and art events and things like that. And we were able to pay for all the paint and brushes and hostel and food and plane tickets and everything. So we paid for everything. And then we worked with the young girls. So it was like for abused women and children, right? And so we like worked on like sustainable art skills, like taught them like some painting workshops, some photography workshops, some drawing workshops and things like that. So it was an amazing experience. But what I want to show you, so we get there ready to paint, and the city's like, you can't paint a mural here. It doesn't go with the aesthetic of the city. We're like, that's something you could have told us before we got here. But but they were actually really cool. We made an agreement that we would paint them on these panels. And they would mount the panels, and if they didn't want them there, like later on, they could be removed and put somewhere else. And then we decided, like, hey, let's make this a community mural. So we'll draw the mural on, and then we'll have the community come and paint the mural in. And then at the end, we touch up where kind of people went outside the lines, things like that. So we were smart enough to actually mount a camera, and we did a time lapse. So you'll get to see a little bit about the project, but I want you to see this mural in progress.
Begging on the feeding line.
So what's so amazing about this is we flyered the city, and when it was like the day for painting, you had viejitos, you had the elders, kids, college students, all painting together. Skip ahead. When I got back, so this series was inspired by that trip, and I just got tired of folks talking about like indigenous communities like we're an extinct people. We're not. We're still here, and our culture survives in the way we cook, the way we dance, the way we raise our children, work with our elders. So we might not dress like our ancestors, but that is in us. That DNA is in us. So I did this series, and I did portraits of friends and family, and then painted kind of these Aztec symbols over their portraits to represent this invisible community that we walk around with every day. This is a little more of a humorous, satirical series I did called Dulces. Guy with the beer with the mazapan behind him, it's called I Fall to Pieces. And if you've ever had mazapan, you know why that's called that. The one with the girl with the crossing churros is "You Don't Know My Life." And then the last one with the concha in the background is my daughter, and it's called "Don't Be Self-Conscious." And the funny thing is, she's very shy and quiet. I'm like, "Mija, you're literally the poster child for don't be self-conscious, and you're self-conscious." And she's like, "I know." All right, this series is called Mujeres Fuertes. You have Be Still, My Corazón. And so she kind of represents love in all its forms. You have the one in the middle. She represents kind of earth and the environment. And the whole thing with the shoe and the nopal is kind of a nod to Wally. And so instead of like the boot with the little plant growing out, it's like, what's the most Chicano shoe out there? Chucks. And the nopal growing out of the chucks. And then the last one is Artista. She represents kind of the arts. And the model is Emilia Cruz, who's an absolutely amazing artist. So I wanted to use a real artist to model an artist. This one, I just want to kind of show a piece that I kind of came back to. So the first one, I love the idea, but just the execution. This is one of my first paintings I ever did. But the idea is that the Mayans holding the symbol chinachli, which means seed, and the little girls holding the symbol xochitl, flower. So the idea is that our ancestors have planted these seeds that have bloomed into flowers with us, the seventh generation. I thought, okay, concept-wise, I love it, but, you know, her head's too big, the shading sucks, you know. So 10 years later, let me try this again. And I used my stepdaughter, Cata, as the model, and it kind of just made it look like she's just kind of walking down the street, and that Mayan's like just tagged on the wall, and she actually has like a flower. So I think I got a little better in 10 years. This series is called Contemporary Codices. So the idea is just taking these things you would see in your own community, right? The everyday people, but in the style of our ancestors, like the codices. So you have Black Lives Matter protesters, the solidarity. You have graduating students. You have the palatero. I have a bunch of different, like a break dancer. I have a mariachi band. I got a zoot suiter. I got a bunch, you know, and one day I'm gonna have to just put them all together. So this is one of my only digital pieces. Most of my paintings are oil, but this one I hand draw them, scan it, and then just color with like Photoshop. Here's just some of my newer paintings. You have, here's one, you know, version of it, but this one's called A Little Prayer for Those Who Migrate. The butterfly wings represent migration. The hummingbirds, they say if you see a hummingbird, that's like an ancestor coming back to visit you. So her ancestors are guiding her along her journey. So it was about the caravans that were about 5 years ago now. And then the one in the middle here, the one, the guy flying in space, that one, the title is The Floor is Racism. So he's just trying to get as far away from the ground as possible to get away from hate, and he's in outer space. Then you have the one in the middle is me and my son, the Luchadores, and that was when he was about 7 years old. He's 26 and doing his PhD at UW now, and so I'm like, oh, I miss when he was a little baby. So I did this, one of my favorite photos of us playing around. You have La Nina. Every year I do a De Los Huertos painting, and that was like from 2020, I think. It's my friend's daughter. When she like posted that picture, she was just kind of dressed as Frida Kahlo, and I was like, oh my God, that's a cute picture of Naomi. I gotta paint it. So it was like around De Los Huertos, like half De Los Huertos face. And then the last one, it's Tlaloc in Seattle, and Tlaloc is the rain god, so I kind of have him playing in the rain. And then the most newest is this one right here. I just finished this up like literally last week. And we have our De Los Huertos exhibition going on at Nepantla right now. And I was literally finishing the cempasúchil flowers like an hour before the show started. I was like, oh. And I was like freaking out the whole time. I was like, oh my God, it's still wet. Please no one bump into it. And then this one is actually, the original is huge. It's 60 by 48. And I just got it back from Tacoma Art Museum. But that one's called Dale, Dale, Dale. And so it's just like, he's, you know, just, you know, broke the piñata, and he's kind of got that hero pose, and all the kids are fighting for it. So it's like complete chaos happening behind him, but he's calm and collected. Then I just want to show you kind of an example of the progression of a painting. So you have the drawing sketched on canvas, kind of the undercoating, which I'm usually at that point like, ugh, this sucks. It's not looking like I want it to look. And then once I put kind of the shadows and light in there, it becomes more dimensional. I'm like, okay, I don't hate it as much. And then this one, you know, with the background. And then the last photo in this was kind of just the symbols at the on the face. And that was a little nerve-wracking because you've completed this painting you like, and I'm going to take this permanent paint pen, and if I screw up, I've screwed up this, like, in painting, I worked on so hard. And so luckily for that, you know, none of them got ruined. Okay, so I'm gonna show you a little video. This is about Nepantla and what we're doing. We have a art gallery in White Center on the border of West Seattle and White Center. We are 4.5 years in, and this I think explains a lot. And then Judy's gonna be talking more about what we do.
Pantla significa el espacio en medio, entre dos mundos, dos tierras, dos identidades.
Yeah, you know, not being Mexican enough for Mexico, not being American enough for America.
You're caught in the middle, porque se de aquí, se de allá, a little bit of everything.
When I got here, there was nothing for the Latinx arts, no physical space in Seattle. But the talent's here, the creativity is here, and we want to highlight that.
I wanted a space that reflects people that look like us, where they could come in and feel embraced, no judgment.
The Nepantla Cultural Arts Gallery is a multi-use, multicultural art space that focuses on marginalized communities and amplifying the voices of artists that aren't always heard in traditional art spaces.
We also offer the space for free community workshops, book readings, lectures.
Our community is underfunded, underrepresented. The only thing we're over is overlooked. Although Latinx folks make up 10% of the population here. Less than 2% of grant funding went to Latinx artists or Latinx-led organizations. People of color, Chicanos were seen as folk art, lowbrow, or just tokenized.
Here in White Center, it's a high immigrant community that's super supportive, but we have real life issues like gang violence. People are sleeping on the street. So when Jake had this idea, I thought, well, what can we offer to our community that brings a space where they're safe, they're accepted, they can make art because art is healing. Not everybody is an artist, but everyone can appreciate art.
Art has been used to mobilize communities, used for social change. And I wanted to make sure that we're providing those tools and making it a free and accessible experience.
It's our duty to give back to our community. If they thrive, we thrive.
All right. Now it is my extreme pleasure to introduce the heart and soul of the Napantla Cultural Arts Gallery, Judy Avitia Gonzalez.
Hi everyone, buenas tardes. As Jake mentioned, I don't usually participate in the lectures. Jake is a star and I'm usually the photographer. So if you see all those really cool pictures, that's my work. So as you saw in the video, at the Napantla Cultural Arts Gallery, we host monthly art exhibitions. We post our calls on social media. They're usually always open to the public. One thing about Napantla is a displaying artist receives 100% if they sell their art. We don't keep a cut. We don't keep a commission. That's our way of supporting artists. Jake, being an artist himself, he knows what it feels like for someone to ask for 30 to 50% of what your art sells for. You know, they call this crazy right from the beginning, but it's worked for almost 5 years. We really make our money from the gift shop. In our gift shop, we really try to highlight Chicana Chicano artists and artisans. Most of the products there are from small business, women makers, LGBTQIA+, some are local, some are from out of state. But really, it's about sharing that platform. What you'll find there, they're usually unique, they're handmade. You are truly supporting a small business, not just ours, but a local maker. In our space, we also offer free arts-related programming. So I would say our mission really is to make art an accessible experience. So we offer free arts-related workshops, book readings. Everything is always free and accessible. We apply to grants, and with that grant money, turn around and give it right back to community. We're able to hire a local artist, pay them a stipend, buy all the supplies needed. We'll currently be hosting a Nichols workshop this Sunday. It's pretty full, but if you come by, we could still make space for you. I guess another thing we're doing in the community is really trying to give back. As Jake mentioned in the video, my family moved here from East LA. We moved to White Center. For me, you know, coming from an area like Boyle Heights, it was a huge culture shock. I didn't want to talk to anyone because I felt like my English wasn't good enough. I didn't see families that looked like my own. There wasn't any panaderias or Mexican stores. And so I just felt really out of place. Fast forward, now I'm a parent. I'm raising our three kids there in White Center. And I wouldn't ever want someone to feel the displacement or feel so ousted the way I did, right, growing up, because that is what we do. We turn to gangs and other things, you know, where you feel accepted. So in our space, we really try to create just a welcoming space, not just for Chicanos, but other marginalized communities. We've been able to host, I would say, over 45 art exhibitions, you know, where we've highlighted AAPI, we've had Black in the Northwest, Chingona's art show, it was all women. And I guess currently, what else are we doing in the community? Oh, one other thing, yeah, we're planning our second annual Dia de los Muertos Arts Festival with Evergreen High School. So that's my alumni, where my kids are now attending. It's really trying to be student-led. I think we've impressed the community, and they kind of wonder, like, well, how is it that you're hosting this again, right? Well, we just ask, what is it that they need? So we come in and try to fill that need. We've made it student-led. There's currently a mariachi program at Evergreen, and it'll be their first performance. They told us we couldn't sell food there, so we took some grant money. We're going to buy all the tamales and champurrado, and we're going to feed the community for free. I guess another thing that we're really proud of is, with all this success that we've had at Nepantla, we've had, you know, big institutions like Seattle Art Museum, Seattle Children's Theater, the Burke, who come out and ask for Jake's art. You know, we want to have Jake come over and present. That's great, you know, but how can we bring you back to our community? Because it's our responsibility to bridge that gap, right? Like, our families, they don't always have the access and the means to make it to downtown. It's not always accessible. So how can we bridge that, right? These spaces, they are for us as well. They're not just for those that can afford it. So I can proudly say that we have tickets for the Seattle Art Museum for our families, able to go there for free. We've also been able to partner with them and have them hire some of our local artists, pay them a stipend, and then offer those same artists space over at Olympic Sculpture Park, as well as Nepantla. So we're making those connections, bridging that gap, and really staying true to our mission of making art an accessible experience.
So here's just some photos of some of the work that we're doing at Nepantla. So we have like one of the painting workshops we did. So every first Saturday, we have a new art opening, new exhibition opens. That's just kind of one of the crowds from one of our shows. It gets really packed for the opening receptions. We had a piñata workshop, and those are some of the kids and families that showed up for the workshop. And then we do tours of Nepantla, so we, field trips. And this is one of, actually, UW Seattle that came out to do a tour. And with that, thank you very, very much. This is how you can get a hold of us, our Instagram, and then websites. Also, these things are for sale. So the big canvases are $250. All the small canvases are $150. $20 prints, $2 postcards and stickers, $2 or 3 for $5. So I try to price my art in so that it's accessible to everyone. My originals have gotten pretty pricey. As I tell people, like, hey, if you can afford an original, congratulations on your life choices. But I can't afford my original. So I try to put different price points so that anybody has access to my art. So we take card, Venmo, cash. So you can, after this, you can come look at all that stuff. But I think we're going to do Q&A, correct? Okay. So hopefully y'all thought of some questions while we were talking.
So we've got two mics, on that, that's okay. You can just like run, and on all like mosey. So we have mics on both sides of the room. So if you have a question, please raise your hand, and one of us with the mics is happy to bring it over. And we're really looking forward to your questions. So raise your hands if you have one. You can also do comments.
Hi, my name is Tolu. Usually they pronounce. I'm here because my wonderful friend Nicole brought me over here. Who works for UW. I think two quick things. Three quick things. I want to give you all props. You all do amazing work in the community. Pour that love. Jake, specifically, the second thing is when you were talking about being in community college and getting the 0.8 to the 2.7. That's a huge accomplishment. I work at a community college and I see students do that, and that's amazing. So I just wanted to hype you up. Like, yes. My question is, you do a lot of work and paintings that feature like ancestors and ancestral knowledge. And so we'd love to know maybe connections to ancestors, what that looks like for either of you in your work, and then how that gets incorporated in your artistic process even before the painting is done, if that's not too personal to ask.
I think ancestry and connecting to my roots is very important in my artwork, probably because I'm overcompensating for looking so white. my dad's Italian American, my mom's Mexican American, and I don't really have any family on my Italian side. It's like my dad is it, right? But I grew up with all my Mexican side, and they're not white passing. They're, you know, more indigenous looking. So growing up with a family that you look nothing like, I think kind of messes your head a little. So I always wished I had black hair and brown eyes and looked like my grandparents and my mom and my cousins and stuff. And so I think whether I've internalized that or what, kind of questioning, you know, how am I connected to this? You know, knowing that it's in my blood, like, but how do I relate to it, you know? And so I think a lot of the work, I think in high school I got teased a lot for being Mexican and kind of defending your culture. Like, I'm sure like when you're at a school with a bunch of Latinos, like it's much easier than like, so I tried to arm myself with like every like Chicano studies book I could find, like in the library or whatever, so that I couldn't be made a fool of, you know, I could arm myself and be ready for it. So I think that kind of started that journey. And then through, you know, Chicano studies and all that, I think it helped have some backbone into my art, right? There's context to it. It's not just pretty flowers, you know, there's a deeper meaning on that. And I think my art is also kind of rife with cultural triggers. For example, like the don't be self-conscious, right? Someone can look at that and maybe not know the Latino culture, the Chicano culture, and like, oh, okay, it's a girl and some like pastry behind her. I don't get it, you know, kind of thing. Where, a concha is very, my grandpa used to take me to the swap meet every Saturday, right? My mom would drop me off and he would have a concha and sweet tea wait for me when I got there. So now a concha just has this very warm feeling. Like there's this, so I hopefully folks see some of this stuff in there and it elicits an emotion, you know. So I hope that answered that question. And then your connection to culture?
Oh.
Your family and culture? Doesn't have to be too long.
Yeah, I guess it's not through art, but I guess I would just say I'm a really proud Chicana. You know, it's like, I wear it just even in the way I speak, in the way I pronounce my name. You know, I make sure I say Gonzalez Avitia because I hear it all the time. Oh, it's Avisha Gonzalez. No, it's Avitia Gonzalez, you know, and I try to offer the same respect to others. But I guess just kind of really staying true and then helping my kids stay connected as well, because it's very easy to lose that, you know, even though Spanish is not, you know, we were colonized and, you know, it's not our natural language, but it is my first language. And so I guess just to me, just really trying to stay connected to those roots, right? Because I don't want to lose it.
Thank you.
Other questions? I think we maybe have time for like two more. Yes.
Hello, my name is Nicole. That's all that matters right now. I just want to say thank you for sharing your story and experience, like, validating yourself with dyslexia, because I'm like, oh, my God, I was thinking about that, and, like, the left-hand, right-hand thing, I'm like, oh, my God, I need to, like, take a test, for real. But I just thank you for sharing the journey, but also sharing the steps in the painting and how you were, like, I hate this part, but this is an important part because this is when I do the lighting and the shading. And those kind of, I don't know if that's like me, like mind meeting you too. Like I see you in your steps and your process because that it it opens the door to art to see how the hell you got to these beautiful finished pieces. And your frustration of working through that is really powerful. So thank you for sharing, you know, such vulnerability, for sharing your process, for being here and blessing us today. And I guess my question is, how do you allow dyslexia to show up in your art or and as a part of yourself now that you know?
So I think, you know, the biggest way that I embraced dyslexia was when, you know, like I was saying, how I realized there's some things I'm not going to be great at, but there's things I am great at and to focus on those things. And I think that's what really threw me into art, that creativeness that I am gifted at. You know, I'm going to focus on that versus I was working a job where I had to turn in reports and were, you know, a lot of detailed oriented things. And I'd always get in trouble because I missed one little thing in there. And it's like, I'm trying, you know, like, and you always, you know, are seen as like, oh, you're not good at this job. Whereas like, no, I really am trying, you know, like I'm not a lazy employee, you know, and I think we're kind of seen like that way. And so throwing myself in a career that I got to exploit, I don't know if that's the best, my talents, you know, and being able to talk to folks about like, about the arts, about careers in the arts, about, you know, embracing your, you know, disabilities, you know, the different things like that, I think I really enjoy. And working with youth, and like, don't listen to those soul crushers, those people that say you can't do that or your art's too ethnic, don't listen to them. I think we're living proof that you can have a career in Chicano arts.
I have one.
Yeah.
Some of us are college students, me included, and I was just wondering if there was a piece of advice that you could give us as college students to kind of like help us get through it, because, you know, I've heard just today, I've heard a lot of us say, hey, I'm having a really hard time this quarter. And so, yeah, is there like a piece of advice that you both would want to give us?
I would say one thing I learned, like a good support system. So when I was in high school, like I was running with folks that like, hey, let's skip school. Like, you know, it wasn't a positive influence on me. And then when I got to college, I was hanging with folks like, hey, let's start a study group. And I was like, well, that's different. And so I went from, you know, hanging with, you know, folks that unfortunately got locked up and a few that passed. But hanging in college, like future doctors and lawyers and professionals that they were motivated and they were going places and they weren't gonna hang with people that weren't as well, right? No one's gonna hold me back, right? And once I started like kind of hanging with those folks, it really kind of motivated me. And I was like, I gotta do that too, right? And so I think just having a good support network of like friends, staff, professors that are pushing you forward rather than holding you back, you know, so. And then your advice for students?
I guess my advice would be exactly what he said, like having the support, because even like, and asking for help, like it's okay to ask for help. Like Jake and I think the reason why like Nepantla is successful is because we're very different. You know, we're like, he's very different than how I am. And some of the things that he's not good at, I excel at, and vice versa, right? So I'm able to support him, and where he's not, like he was saying, you know, his dyslexia, he needs help with some things. I excel at those things. So kind of having someone that can support you in areas where you need that support, I think that's like so important, because that's how we're able to thrive, because we help each other. And I do ask for help, you know, because there's life going on, right? Aside from school, you have your social life and you have your family and other things, your work. So I think just really trying to find that balance and surrounding yourself with support, you know, whatever that may look like, I think that's really important.
Any other questions from folks? Oh, we got one over here.
Hi, I'm Anna. And I was just wondering, after having your diagnosis of dyslexia, how did that like change your life? And also how, like, were there any ways that it stayed the same? Like, did you still doubt yourself with the diagnosis?
Yeah, I mean, it's a diagnosis, it's not a cure, right? So you just, okay, I know I have this. I know these are the steps I can take to make life easier on me. But yeah, like when I found out I was dyslexic, I was still working as a college recruiter at Northridge for probably another 3 years. And then in 2015, I think is when I, or no, probably about 2017 is when I became a full-time artist and just like completely like dropped, you know, higher ed. But yeah, there was still the, you know, you're still kind of seen, like there's these like, I don't know the word for it, but for example, I can be seen as a very messy person, right? Like a very, like my desk would be like just all over the place. But to me, it has to be like that because I know I can visually see where everything is, right? But someone walks into my office and like, oh, this guy is just disorganized and messy. And Judy, like I'll have things kind of like that at Nepantla, and then she comes in like, oh, this place is messy, I gotta clean up. And she cleans like, oh, where's this, where's that? I don't know where's this now? So my boss, I would tell them like, hey, you know, I'm dyslexic. I'm having trouble with these things. I'm not trying to like, not, you know, I'm not trying to be lazy. I'm not trying to miss this. This is real. Like I have documentation now. Oh, okay. Yeah. Well, you know, and then like I would, you know, kind of mess up on something like detailed thing. And they like, I'm like, do you think that I like it just went away? Like, like I'm still like this. Like it's going to be like this. I'm warning you, like, you know, so it's still going to be with you. It's not a cure, but, and people are still going to judge you. Right? But you just have to find ways that make your life as easy and blissful as possible and work with it. Because with dyslexia specifically, you know, I can't talk to the other, you know, anything else. I'm dyslexic, so I know. But for me, you know, there's gifts. There's things like, I'm glad I'm dyslexic, right? Like there's things that like, I love doing it. I'm good at like art and talking and being creative and things like that. I love that I'm good at that stuff, right? So I also think like, hey, I'm blessed, you know? So hope that helps.
Sorry, we were organizing the raffle for half a second. I think we do have time for one more quick question. If there's anybody, oh, we got one in the back over there, please. Oh, also, if you have like a little piece of paper and you want to join the raffle and you haven't already, like go ahead and send that up.
What are we supposed to put on the paper?
Your name.
Oh. Okay, thank you. My name is Ariana Ochoa Camacho, and I'm a professor of Latino studies here. And one of the questions I have for you is, when you were at that point where you were 0.8, what helped you shift? Because that was before you hit ethnic studies, right?
Yeah.
What would be helpful from your campus community? What supported you in that process? Because it is big, and it is big considering you hadn't yet found your major, right? Yeah. Your thing.
So the part I skipped because I was trying to go fast was, so at the end of the at the end of the quarter, you know, I got this 0.8 GPA, and I was going to drop out. Like, that was going to be it. That was going to be my college career. Like, I tried it. I was like, see, I'm stupid. I'm dumb. I proved it. I'm out of here. I'm not college material. I was fortunate. I was visiting the Multicultural Services Office at Bellevue Community College back then. And a counselor, you know, asked if I wanted to join the Latino Club on campus. And I told her, yeah, I looked into it. There actually isn't one on this campus. And she was like, oh, well, how about next quarter you start it? And I was like, yeah, next quarter I'm not coming back. Like, and she was like, wait, you know, what's wrong? And I told her about my grades, and she said, let me see your schedule. And she looked at my schedule and said, like, you took the wrong classes. I don't know who got you this schedule, but these are really hard classes for your first semester. You have these huge gaps in between classes. She's like, if you come back one more quarter, I'll help you pick out your classes, and it'll be, you know, won't be those big gaps. It'll be an easier schedule, and we can get the Latino Club started. So I was like, all right, I'll give it one more quarter. I'm not promising anything out of further than that. Yeah, so then, you know, like, started, you know, was the Latino Pride Association for the first quarter, and then we became Mecha, and I was like the president of Mecha, and I was like all like, oh, I'm someone cool now, right? And that gave me a lot of confidence. And going to like the Student of Color Conference and getting really involved, and just like I it wasn't like I found these smart glasses and I was like, oh, let me put these on and now school is easy. Like I still struggled at math. I had to go to the math lab every day just so I could get through it. I had to work really hard. I think my son was a major motivator to really, you know, do my best. But yeah, that's kind of how I got through and got my grades up and was able to transfer.